talking about the transport equation, and we stopped when we derived one-dimensional equation. So for one-dimensional special case when x was just a variable, so and we had this equation. We also mentioned in the previous lecture that we can talk about n-dimensional equation, and we kind of have shown this linear transport equation. So now let's derive this equation. So basically the derivation follows the same step as for one-dimensional case. I just thought that when you see one-dimensional case, you can clearly understand the process, and n-dimensional case just repeats everything, but the only difference is we just involve more vector calculus. Right, so now let's try to derive this equation. So what we assume? We assume that we have fluid flow somewhere in Rn, and we have some contaminant, ink or paint, inside, such that does not affect the flow itself. And we want to study the concentration of this ink or contaminant. Write down an equation that describes the change in concentration, and then just by solving this equation we will find concentration as a function of space and time. Right, so then we assume that U is concentration that depends on vector x, our n-dimensional vector, right, where all x1, xn are independent variables, and we have t as a time, and v is velocity vector of our fluid, and this is n-dimensional vector, it has components v1 and so on up to vn. And so if you remember, in one-dimensional case we were considering just thin tube, so now in n-dimensional case we consider some region U in Rn, and instead of small segment that we were considering before from x1 to x2, we will consider small ball, a ball that is somewhere in the domain U. And then how we can write down amount of ink in this ball at time t. So we have this integration over the ball, right? So it's just volume of the ball, so x here corresponds to the volume, n-dimensional volume, and this is amount of ink in the ball at time t, so we have x, we have t. And also this ball has the boundary, let's call it db, right? Partial db, it's standard notation for the boundary of our ball. And let's talk about outflow through the boundary, right? So something may come in, something may come out, and we will compute the amount during the time interval from t1 to t2. So that would be integral from t1 to t2 with respect to time. And since we're talking about the boundary, integration will be along the boundary of our ball. And as before, it will depend on concentration, on velocity vector, and now we have to include normal derivative that would describe our normal derivative to the boundary of our ball. And we will take n as outward normal, so outward, not normal derivative, outward normal vector, and we will take unit vector, right? So n is, again, n is unit normal to the boundary of our ball, to the sphere. And what our balance equation will look like, it just everything would be similar to one-dimensional case. So balance equation is, so what is the amount of ink in the ball at time t, right? So we have to have an integral over the ball, over this volume at time t, and that would be the same as we had at time t2, at time t1, right? Say t1 is less than t2, previous moment of time. and minus how much ink was going out of the boundary, so minus T1, T2 integral along the boundary, U, V, and M, right? So this integral. So that would be our main balance equation, our conservation of mass. And then we will write version of fundamental theorem of calculus similarly. So because we want to combine these two integrals, so we can write them as, since here we have T2 and here we have T1, we can write them as a double integral along the ball when we differentiate u with respect to time and differentiate and then integrate, and that will give us just evaluation at points T2 and T1. So this formula we will apply to these two integrals, so combining this. And now let's look at the second integral. To modify the second integral, we need to recall the divergence theorem from vector calculus. So if we have an arbitrary smooth vector field E that depends on our special variable X, then divergence theorem relates integral over the region with integral across the boundary. So this is special case of very good Stokes theorem. Maybe I will just talk about Stokes theorem someday. Just today I don't want to go very, very far from my goal, that is deriving the transport equation. So then, and you have seen this formula in calculus class, so it's not a new formula, right? That relates integral over the ball with, or doesn't matter if it's a ball, it's integral over a region with integral across the boundary. And this we take is this divergence theorem, and as E, we will take the product of our function u, u is a scalar times v. So the v is a vector, velocity vector, so that would be our vector. And then if I just replace E here with u and v, and if I add integration with respect to time, because we have it in here, it will not change anything, then we will have integral from T1 to T2 over across the boundary of this, and then I will keep the same integration with respect to time and just apply divergence theorem and switch from integration across the boundary to the integration over the region. And now let's apply fundamental calculus theorem and divergence theorem to our main balance equation. So I just mark in red, first two integrals can be replaced using fundamental theorem of calculus and will give us this integral. And now I put this integral here, right? So it is here. And then the second integral in purple, to replace this integral, we will use divergence theorem. So we will replace this with this one, with divergence. So this term I copied in here. And the sum equals to zero. So this is our new version of our main balance equation. And now, since we assume that B is an arbitrary ball in our domain U, and T1, T2 is an arbitrary period of time. And if, in addition, or maybe I mentioned this earlier, we assume that U is a continuous function of its argument and its first derivative is also continuous in our region U, then from this integral B equals zero, we can conclude that the integrand is zero, so we write a derivative with respect to u plus divergence of this product is zero. So this is our differential equation, and I showed it in the previous lecture that the divergence of scalar times vector equals to gradient of the scalar dot product with the vector plus scalar times divergence of vector. And also in the previous lecture we discussed that we will, if we want to consider divergence free field, so if our fluid is incompressible, then divergence of vector V is zero, and then in this case, using this formula, we can see that it's a sum of two terms, and the second term, if divergence V is zero, second term will disappear, and we will, instead of this term, we will just end up with the first was gradient U times vector V. I put it in here, so this way we will end up with our linear transport equation that we wanted to derive, and this equation will hold in every way in our region U and for every time t. Okay, now let's start talking about solutions of the transport equation, and we will start with one-dimensional case. Right, so suppose we have the transport linear transport equation, one-dimensional case. So this is our equation, derivative of u with respect to t plus v d u dx equals to zero for any x and t in some domain where x and t are changing. And we will be talking about classical solutions. It means when we assume that function u is a continuous function of its variables x and t, and first order derivatives with respect to x and t are also continuous. And now let's, so we have two variables x and t, and let's look at the plane, xt plane, right? And in this plane, let's consider a curve. And let's consider a curve in its parametric form, right? So let's introduce parameter s just to remind you. So what is a parametric curve? We assume that if we have somewhere curve in the space or in the plane that cannot be expressed as a function of one variable with respect to another, it's we all always can use parametric representation. But we can use parametric representation even if we can express one with respect to another. So we assume that we have S. S is a parameter that runs along a straight line. So it could be a segment, but in our case, S could run from negative infinity to infinity. And for each point here, we have X as function of S and T as function of S, and that will give us a curve. I just draw here a segment with endpoints, so this point is mapped here. So a parametric representation or parameterization of a curve, it's a mapping, right? It's mapping between the segment and a curve. And then, so we have this curve, x as a function of parameters s and t as a function of parameter s. And then we assume that our function u is a smooth function. We said that it's continuous, its first derivative continuous, and then so it is a C1 function. And then let's compute derivative, just total derivative along this curve C. So then to do this, we we write u, right, x will be on the curve and t on the curve. And then we compute derivative with respect to parameter s. So we use chain rule, we differentiate u with respect to first argument, u with respect to x, and then x with respect to as red x is a function of only one parameter, so we don't use here partial derivative, and then plus derivative with respect to the second argument du dt, and then dt ds. And this would be derivative along this curve C. Curve C, it's some curve at this moment. And then let's add some conditions. Let's assume that curve C is such that dx ds is v and dt ds is 1. So if we have this condition, then from here we will have, we can replace dx ds with v and dt ds with 1, right, from here. And then if we look at this entire expression, this expression coincides with our equation, so this whole thing equals to 0. So, and then what do we have here? If we look at the beginning and at the end, we see that du ds equals 0, which means that our function u, if its derivative is 0, then function is constant on our curve C. And from here we can see that our function solves our PDE, it's equivalent to our functions to be constant on the curve C, right? Because the equation must be satisfied on every curve in our domain. And now let's see, what is our curve C? And if you remember, when we were deriving this equation, we assumed that V is a constant, right? Otherwise we had slightly different equation. V was under the differentiation. So V is constant. So if V is constant, if this is the case, right, then let's solve this simple system of ODEs. Then we integrate, right, and X would be V times S plus some constant. Let's call this constant X sub zero. And T will be S plus some constant. Let's call this constant T sub zero. Right, and then let's eliminate S from these two equations. If we eliminate S, say S is T minus T sub zero, so I will plug it in here, X equals V, instead of S I will plug T minus T sub zero plus X sub zero. Or T sub zero, V, and X sub zero, they're constant. So I move them all in one side and move my variables on the other side, so I will have x minus vt equals x sub zero minus vt sub zero, and this is a constant. So what we have, that x minus vt is a constant. And by the way, I forgot to mention that if you look at this representation of our curve C, you can easily recognize here that this is parametric equation of a line. Parametric equation of the line that passes through the point x naught, y naught, in the direction of v1. So this is equation of a line. So our curve C is a line. And then from here we can see that if we take x minus vt as a solution, right, that this would be actually a solution to our equation. Just check if you differentiate with respect to x, you have v, with respect to t we have minus v, so it is zero. And in addition, if we consider any function, any arbitrary function f of one, let's say, differentiable function, so and we assume that it can differentiate, derivative is continuous, of one variable, right? And then we can consider f of x minus vt. So we can see that this function, as well as a constant function on C, and this function as well solves our PD, right? If you just differentiate it, you will see that you're getting identity. So what is the big conclusion from here? That as we have seen for ODEs, when we are talking about general solution, we had an arbitrary constant, right? If we had ODE of the first order one equation. So, and now with PDEs, we have first order one equation, and we see that its general solution involves an arbitrary function. Now let's talk about general solution to the n-dimensional case. So basically we will just repeat everything we just said for a one-dimensional case. So this is our equation, right? Du dt, v is a constant vector, and x is n-dimensional vector, and plus we have t and time. Right, again, let's consider a parametric curve in its parametric representation, and this curve would be in, now it's n, n plus t, n plus, n plus 1. Right, so s is parameter that runs from negative infinity to infinity, right, our vector x, each component of vector x depends on s now, and t depends on s. And then let's consider our function u on this curve. So then it will be u of vector x depending on parameter s, and t depends on parameter s. And as before, let's compute the derivative of our function along the curve with respect to s. So again, we will use the chain rule, and that would be du d first x, x1, then dx, dx1 ds plus du dx2, dx2 ds, du dxn, dxn, ds, plus du dt and dt ds. And then again, what if we set all derivative of x, vector x with respect to s, they will be equal to v, so dx1 ds v1, dx2 ds v2, and so on, and dt ds equals to 1. Right, and then in this case, if we look at this expression and then replace each derivative with respect to s, x with respect to s with corresponding component of vector v, and with respect to t, or derivative of t with respect to x at s with 1, we will get here that what we have here, we have gradient of u, right? So we have du dx1, du dx2, du dxn times vector v. And here we just have a derivative of u with respect to t, since dt ds we set to be 1. And if we do so, we will realize that the expression we have here is just exactly the left-hand side of our equation, so this would be 0. And from here, we can conclude that u is constant along our curve C, and since v is a constant, we can easily integrate these equations, and we can see that C is a line, a straight line, in the space r n plus 1, so n spatial variables plus time. And so we can easily integrate this simple system. We'll get vector x of s is vector v times s plus x sub 0, and t of s is s plus t sub 0, where x sub 0 and t sub 0 are some constants. And from this consideration, we can conclude that the following three things are equivalent. So u is a solution, classical solution to our equation that we, our transport, linear transport equation. This is the first statement. Second statement, u is constant along straight line. For any smooth function f of vector y, where y is an n-dimensional vector, our general solution to our equation u of x t is this arbitrary function of the argument vector x minus vector v times t.